And now it's my great pleasure to introduce our first speaker. The perfect opening for this conference or any conference, in that she has the highest on-base percentage of any academic speaker in the history of academic speaking. Hilary Schor is my dear friend, I say up front, and colleague here at USC, where she holds several concurrent appointments as professor of English and also professor of law, along with a professorship in gender studies. As we meet here, departments of earth science, metallurgical engineering, music, and botany are meeting to try to bring her into their folds. There is nothing she can't do, and though she doesn't do absolutely everything, what she doesn't do isn't worth doing. She has directed the Center for Law, History, and Culture here at USC, the Center for Feminist Research, was president of the Academic Senate and director of the Feminist Council. Hilary has won numerous awards, including an ACLS grant, a Stanford Humanities Center Fellowship, several teaching and research fellowships here at USC, and a Guggenheim Fellowship. Professor Schor is prominent in the field, in so many fields, by way of her outstanding scholarship and generous presence at conferences and symposia all over the country and Europe. Her books include Scheherazade in the Marketplace, Elizabeth Gaskell in the Victorian Novel, published by Oxford University Press, and Dickens and the Daughter of the House, published by Cambridge. She is currently completing a book on the complex relationship between women, curiosity, and the rise of the novel, entitled Curious Subjects, Women and the Trials of Realism. She speaks to us today on Realism's Alice, Making the Heroine Curious. Hilary?
Better? Wave furiously if I get too loud, because I tend to get very enthusiastic. Also, I talk too fast, and if my mother were here, she'd be yelling, slow down, the way she used to when I practiced the piano. It's a great honor to be here today. I'm very much aware of speaking to people who know a great deal more about Lewis Carroll than I. Maybe even more than Professor Kincaid, though I would never suggest such a thing. But I did visit the website, and oh man, you guys are cool. And great website, by the way. It's a pleasure as well to speak in this beautiful room. And those of you from the library, those of you who have been here for many years, or even a few, know what enormous changes have gone on in the USC libraries in the last few years. And it's just a treat to be able to reap some of the benefits of the hard work of faculty and librarians in making this library, in particular, the jewel and the crown. And I feel a real rush whenever I stand in this room and think, God, we did this. We really did it. And to welcome so many friends here. But I must pause a moment. It was 20 years ago today, Sergeant Pepper taught the band to play. It was 20 years ago. Just a little bit more, that my friend and mentor and buddy, Rob Paul Hemus, introduced me to a tall, courtly, lovely man who leaned down to me and said, and what insects do you delight in? The first time I met Jim Kincaid was at an MLA panel, December 1986, so truly 20 years, and he gave an outrageous paper. And I offended him by telling him so. But I figured if we were going to be colleagues for the rest of our lives, I should just say what I think. That was the first of many mistakes I made. And I have been playing a prim and unimaginative Alice to his delightful Mr. Dodgson ever since. His friendship is truly the most important thing about my years at USC. And the gifts he has given me are more numerous even than those that Lewis Carroll gave us with these wonderful books. So it's a pleasure to stand here and thank my friend. My paper has an epigraph from Through the Looking Glass. What is this? The unicorn said at last. This is a child. We only found it today. It's as large as life and twice as natural. When I began writing this talk, I wanted to answer a series of what I'll call diagnostic questions about Alice's adventures in Wonderland and its relationship to curiosity. But I began to bump into a series of much more basic questions about this text, like, what is it? How do we read it? What, to answer the question of this conference, is a child? What is a child in a book? Is there a child in this book? What is the conjunction of hero and author and text? Once we've answered those questions and sat down to read the book, what are we to make of it? What are we to make of its role in our literary tradition? Is Alice itself just a literary curiosity? What in it still makes us curious? What is it that makes its heroine so curious to us, and we suspect us so curious to her? This is a ridiculous series of questions worthy of Wonderland itself. But like Alice, burning with curiosity, I must begin somewhere. So I begin at the novel's beginning. Emma Woodhouse, handsome, clever, and rich. It is a truth universally acknowledged. No. There was no possibility of taking a walk that day. Was she beautiful or not beautiful? Under certain circumstances, there are few hours in life more agreeable than the hour dedicated to the ceremony known as afternoon tea. I'm sure those are not the right words. Alice was beginning. Oh, yeah. Okay, that's better. Alice was beginning to get very tired of sitting by her sister on the bank and having nothing to do. Okay, right, now we're well underway. Alice was beginning to get very tired of sitting by her sister on the bank and having nothing better to do. Once or twice she had peeped into the book her sister was reading, but it had no pictures or conversations in it. And what is the use of a book, thought Alice, without pictures or conversation? Whatever else you say about it, Alice's Adventures in Wonderland certainly has pictures and conversations. But apart from these self-advertised features, look, Ma, I can talk. How can we begin to talk about this strange book as a novel? As I have begun by suggesting, and believe me, I could have gone on in this vein, this book fits a little more easily than we might have imagined into the tradition of the English realist novel, with its focus on the heroine, handsome, clever, rich, that's our Alice, its constraints on female mobility. Alice, like Jane Eyre, begins her story by turning away from a not quite exciting enough book. It begins by questioning its heroine. Is she beautiful? Is she not beautiful? And with what Henry James cleverly identifies, along with Lewis Carroll, as the central element of any English novel, the agreeableness of the hour dedicated to the ceremony known as afternoon tea. But it is not the ceremony of tea that I want us to attend to today, delightful as that might sound on this cloudy morning. Instead, I want us truly to consider just what kind of book this is. It is not, as the pigeon says to Alice when Alice denies being a serpent, although she admits to eating eggs, a likely story. It is unlikely. It is full of coincidences, uncanny transformations, words made things, and wishes made flesh. But I think the least likely explanation of what kind of book it is that it's not real. Now that's the explanation that Alice and her sister collude to give at the end of the novel, as the book spends several pages trying to undo everything that has come before. As Alice fights off the whole pack of playing cards that has risen up against her, she finds herself lying on the bank with her head in the lap of her sister, who is fanning away dead leaves. "Wake up, Alice, dear. What a long sleep you've had," says her sister. "Oh, I've had such a curious dream," says Alice. And she tells her sister all the strange events that you have just been reading about. And her sister kisses her and says, "It was a curious dream, dear. Certainly, now run to your tea." Maybe this is a talk about tea after all. Alice gets up and runs off, and I'm quoting again, "thinking while she ran, as well she might, what a wonderful dream it had been." Then the sister, too, begins to dream, and she dreams the same events, as the whole place became alive with the strange creatures of her little sister's dream, and the long grass rustled at her feet as the white rabbit hurried by, the frightened mouse splashed his way. She could hear the rattle of teacups, the shrill voice of the queen ordering off her unfortunate guests. Once more, the pig baby was sneezing on the Duchess's knee while plates and dishes crashed around it. And so on, as the narrator offers us an auditory recap of the whole novel. But this instant replay is in the service of debunking everything we have just read. The sister sits there with closed eyes, half believing herself in Wonderland, though, and I'm quoting again, "she knew she had but to open her eyes again and all would change to dull reality. The grass would only be rustling in the wind and the pool rippling to the waving of the reeds. The rattling teacups would change to tinkling sheep bells and the queen's shrill cry to the voice of the shepherd boy. and on and on and on, turning everything we have witnessed into mere physical phenomena, easily transformed by the dreaming self into a wonderful alternative world, but finally only, as she knows, the confused clamor of the busy farmyard. This is a fairly conventional realist ending, and of course it will return more successfully in the film version of The Wizard of Oz. I had a dream, and you were there, and you were there, and you were there. This is always a good way to read books. Start at the ending. Accept its conclusions. Accept its disillusions. So ends many a gothic novel. The dead body was a waxwork. The worms were threads of cloth. The horrible chest contains only a laundry list. But here's why it doesn't work, and why it won't help us in our understanding of what kind of book this is and what it has to say to us today. For starters, this explanation in and of itself doesn't really make sense. If anything, Lewis Carroll did too good a job at what he claims was his purpose in writing the book, disguising its status as a dream. As he wrote to a friend after he finished it, the heroine spends an hour underground and meets various birds, beasts, etc., no fairies, endowed with speech. The whole thing is a dream, but I don't want that revealed till the end. But the end doesn't feel like something revealed. It feels like suddenly the rules have changed. And look again at what Carroll said about his writing of the book. He wanted not a fairy tale, no fairies, but the natural world made even more amazing. It is no accident that when he went to illustrate his book, he borrowed a volume of natural history. Even more than that, and this is what I will be focusing on today in my discussion of the book's form, this convincing disillusionment isn't what we feel while we're reading the novel. And it isn't what marks the book, makes it interesting or scary or curious. It isn't what stands for Alice in the popular imagination. What the ending of Alice puts forward, falsely, I am arguing, is the version of realism that shouts out, "It's a dream. Now grow up. Be realistic and put your toys away." It's the version of realism in which the ordinary world is reasserted firmly at the end of the fiction, and we are reassured that we must not believe anything other than what we already believe. And I would say neither the best science fiction, which this is, nor the best realist fiction, which this also is, will ever be content with such an ending. What the best versions of realism propose, and this is what I claim for Alice, is that we cannot explain everything away. It's that the novel creates a world of wonder, but one that is consistently recognizable, that runs by its own inherent, coherent rules. What is scariest in Alice is not that it is a dream, but that it is our world, just a little bit off. It is, in Alice's words, curiouser and curiouser. What I want today is to explore that curiosity in all its complexity in the text, and restore that complexity both to the novel's heroine and to realism itself. To do that, I will have to describe what I mean by curiosity. I will have to take a stab at what makes the heroine curious, but I want to begin by explaining the other one of my key terms, complexity. I mean something quite precise by complexity. Let me begin by saying what it is not. It is not a puzzle. It is not a logic game or something that can be solved by a concordance or a key or a secret affinity. And I need to be clear, this is probably the chief reason why everyone's answer to my question, what kind of book is this, is it, that this is a novel. It isn't a novel, they say, because we know it's this other thing. And we know that Lewis Carroll, whatever else he was, wasn't a novelist. How do I know this? How do I know that we all know this? Well, I have two irrefutable sources. The first is Wikipedia, where all knowledge resides. And the other is this conference's program. Now, if you go to Wikipedia, and I did this because I'm a scholar, and you look up thematic elements in Alice books, this is what you are given. And hand to God, I'm just reading the list. Bullet points, puns, parody and satire, games and riddles, nonsense, Freudian elements, dreams and nightmares, similarities to psychedelic experiences, in jokes about the little family and the Oxford community, and my favorite, parable. You'll find something similar on the website for today's conference. It describes the Alice books thus, and I quote, "The books which highlight Carroll's sense of the absurd and love for logic puzzles remain popular with adults and children." You will not find the fact that Carroll read and reread 19th century novels. You will not find out that he incorporates novelistic elements everywhere in his books. You will not find, despite the interest in puzzles and games, his fascination with the visual world of the realist novel, its obsession with optics and perception, on which we will focus today. What these critics mean by complexity is a game with a key, a book much closer to Looking Glass than Alice's Adventures, on which I am choosing to focus. What I mean by complexity is something far different from the world of games parody written. And I will argue similarly that it's a very different form of curiosity than that of the puzzle master that sends Alice herself burning with curiosity down the rabbit hole. Curiosity has to be one of the most popular words in Wonderland, and it has a delicious slipperiness that its nearest cognates, queer and wonderful, never attain. Look at all the astonishing ways you can deploy curiosity. Alice is curious about many, many things, including the rabbit and his pocket watch, the frog in footman's livery, she felt curious to know what it was all about, the Mad Hatter's watch, and what whiting are made of. Without saying whether or not she's curious about them, she notices that many things are curious in themselves. The duck and Dodo and Lori and Eaglet are all curious creatures. The door in the tree is very curious. The croquet game and the gardener painting the roses and the song about the whiting are all curious. And the Cheshire Cat is the most curious thing I ever saw in my life, which at this point in the novel is saying a great deal. But Alice is curious in the other sense as well, for the creatures of Wonderland are just as curious about her as she is about them. Your hair wants cutting, says the Hatter, who has been staring at Alice for some time in great curiosity. Indeed, the longer Alice is in Wonderland, the more curious she becomes, not just to them, but to herself, and the more curious she is about her own experience. What a curious feeling. I must be shutting up like a telescope. It's rather curious, you know, this sort of life. I wonder what's happening to me. Everything is curious today. Or, as she retorts in a moment of such confusion that she fails to speak good English, curiouser and curiouser. It seems to me no accident that Lewis Carroll contributed the one modern version of curiosity to the Oxford English Dictionary. He's playing throughout the novel with, the curious nature of curiosity, which is to be puzzlingly objective and subjective at the same time. Curiosity is something you have about other things, but it's also something you are. Is the Cheshire Cat curious because we want to know about it, or because it is curious about us? Both objective and subjective senses of curiosity come to us with a range of different meanings. This is your little linguistic lesson for the day. Curiosities are objects invested with meaning, with wonder, with cunning craftsmanship, or magic properties. They are also curious not just because they are well-made or unusual, other dictionary meanings, but because we are curious about them. To be curious about something is not just to be interested in it, but to inquire too closely. And it is in keeping with the violence of the curious imagination of Alice's adventures in Wonderland to remind herself that it is curiosity that killed the cat. My own interest in curiosity, however, has to do not only with this doubleness, subjective, objective, self and object, but with its pervasive association in Western culture, and particularly in the English novel, with the heroine. And you could think yourself back not just to the Sphinx or Pandora or Eve, but to the heroines with whom I began, Emma Woodhouse, Elizabeth Bennet, Gwendolyn Harlett, Isabel Archer, to remind yourself just how much the novel needs female curiosity in both senses, the sense both of the heroine who wants to know, like Alice, more than she ought, and the heroine whose adventures are the endless source of fascination and interest to those around her. What will Isabel Archer do? Let's give her some money and find out, as if she were a fascinating lab experiment, which is, of course, the way she treats herself as well. But even if I weren't obsessed with this question, and clearly I am, the question of the duplicitous curiosity of the 19th century heroine, Lewis Carroll would be doing my work for me. For he makes exactly the same word puzzle out of his heroine when he is describing her. This very curious child, he says, was in the habit of pretending to be two people. Alice is a very curious child, and not just because she plunges down a rabbit hole with no reason but a rabbit with a pocket watch, though I must say, for the record, it would be a strange person who didn't follow such a rabbit. But I think Carroll is onto something in particular when he connects her curiosity not just with a world of unexpected rabbit objects, rabbits, not just with watches, but pockets to put them in, but with her own dynamic self-consciousness, with her habit of talking to herself, her willingness to see herself in the third person, as it were, her habit, dare I say, of thinking like a narrator. For at the moment when the Carolian narrator, up to his annoying and slightly snide tricks, invokes Alice's curiousness, Alice herself has discovered the limits of her intelligence and self-awareness. This moment of her curiosity is the moment when she has shrunk too far to reach the golden key on the glass table outside the tiny door. As if Alice could overhear the narrator's comments on her fictional style, curious child, you have it pretending, blah, 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 she reacts with total acerbity. But it's no use now to pretend to be two people. Why, there's hardly enough of me left to make one respectable person. Seriously, just ask. What makes Alice curious? What makes her remarkable? What is it she wants to know? In a sense, this is the real puzzle of the novelist. I am arguing it is throughout the realist tradition. As I will suggest eventually, it is no accident that this novel ends with a trial, where the final question of its final witness, Alice herself, is, what do you know? The status of women's knowledge is always the trial of the novel, or at least of the novels I'm involving today. But I think the question of what Alice wants to know has a slightly different answer, one that helps to illuminate not only the world of Wonderland, but the curious world of fiction itself. I think what Alice wants to know, and what the text wants to know as well, is fairly straightforward, if unexpected. Alice wants to know, how big am I? At this point, do we have Xeroxes? At this point, why don't we take a second and just give you the Xeroxes? I'm going to resume. So what was my question? How big is she? Now, the question of how big Alice is not unrelated to the question of how curious she is, because her shifting size is what makes Alice interesting to herself through most of the book. And it is often what makes her of interest to others, especially when she's knocking them over or pushing them down. But this poses a problem of fictional knowledge as well. Alice isn't the right size from the moment she gets to Wonderland. She is constantly trying to find a stable element outside of herself to measure herself by. But what she's doing is measuring herself, like any character in any novel, by objects in a purely imaginary world. For this reason, and because she simply doesn't get the inability of knowing the size of anything, she's constantly insulting the creatures around her. She tells the 3-inch caterpillar that 3 inches is a wretched size to be. He says, rearing himself upright as he spoke, it is a very good height indeed. But Alice is also attempting complicated reality games, which are nothing more than elaborate forms of talking to herself, pretending to be two persons, one whose body is shifting, and the other whose sense of self wants to stay still. How tall is Alice really? What can size mean in a novel? Lewis Carroll, in his letters and essays, adapted the Thackerayan habit of referring to his characters as puppets, presenting them as diminutive playthings to be picked up and put away in turn. But he has Alice do much the same thing when she knocks the jurors out of the jury box and must return them promptly and carefully, for she thinks of them as being just like the goldfish that she knocked out of their bowl the week before, in danger of dying outside their element. Remember, she very carefully dismisses the lizard in upside down, and then she has to turn him right side up. I think Carol is right that we, too, imagine fictional characters as at once life-sized, even imposing or magisterial figures. I know Dorothea Brooke is taller than I am. But also miniature, occupying a dollhouse of the mind, playing with fiction-sized furniture and cunning little objects in a dream house that we half occupy with them. My point here is merely that he writes this fantasy large, in imagining Alice's bodily woes. And that this feeling, this awareness of a fundamentally unknowable body in an ever-changing physical world is the primary effect of Alice as fiction. Let me just remind you of Alice's fantastical transformations, how many changes she undergoes in the course of the novel. And I must say, I liked this idea when I began, and when I actually started counting, I decided I was a genius. I mean, there are like 100. Alice begins at the usual size, but we must call that size X, because we don't know. She doesn't say. She tells you over and over again how old she is, but she never says, and I was 4 feet and more. Similarly, we don't know exactly where she begins, because she never names the place. We know that she falls many miles from there, near to the center of the Earth, and is, or so Alice guesses, 4,000 miles down, I think, and falls through the center to the Antipodes. Once there, she is presumably still her usual size, but the objects are all wrong. Or rather, they're not wrong in themselves, but they don't go properly with one another. Either, as she says, the locks are too big, or the keys are too small, but nothing fits. Faced with a three-legged table, a gold key, and a door that is 15 inches high, or a markedly precise measurement for a girl who cannot say the word Antipodes, Alice wishes that she could shut up like a telescope, for she had begun to think very few things were really impossible. Instantly, A magic bottle appears and says, "Drink me." She does, and promptly, yes, shuts up like a telescope. "What a curious feeling," Alice remarks. But although she is now 10 inches high, she can no longer reach the golden key. And more, she begins to worry that she might go out altogether like a candle. It is at this point that she remarks that there is not enough of her to make one respectable person, but her eye falls on a little glass box where she finds a very small cake with the words "Eat Me" beautifully marked out in currants. I imagine it looking like stone. She eats, and at first nothing happens. This is generally what happens when one eats cake. But Alice had got so much into the way of expecting nothing but out-of-the-way things to happen that she is quite disappointed. But then in no time at all, she is opening up like the largest telescope that ever was, and is now more than 9 feet high. It is at this moment that she is forced to expand language as well, like a telescope, to meet her needs. It's at that moment that she invents the word curiouser, because she needs to make curiosity itself longer to fit what she feels. Alice regretfully says goodbye to her feet, which she never expects to reach again. Then she sits there in some despair, fanning herself, until she idly puts on the rabbit's tiny gloves, at which point, and not before, she realizes that she has shrunk again. She found that, as nearly as she could guess, she was now about 2 feet high and was shrinking rapidly, so she dropped 7 feet without noticing until she can test her size against the gloves. See what I'm getting at? This is weird. Discovering that she is holding a magic fan, duh, she drops it just in time to save herself from shrinking away altogether. Alas, although she's the right size for the tiny door, once again the door is shut, the key is far away, and we're still, having cried herself a pool of tears, Alice is about to float away in it. "I wish I hadn't cried so much," she calls out. But she begins to hear loud, scary noises, and she thinks, "Oh, it's a walrus, it's a hippopotamus." But of course, she, in her tiny Alice state, is now afraid of a mouse. And the pool is soon crowded with birds and animals that have all fallen in it, and they're all curious. But they're curious only in relationship to her. That is, they're the same as they ever were. It's just that she's now the same size as they. What makes them curious is that they are now people size, or rather she is, as Charles Dickens would no doubt remark, altogether diminutive. In some ways, alas, these things are a parable. Alice is confused two states, growing up as in taller and growing up as in older. And she does so throughout the book. This is both the running joke of a comic novel and the haunting tale of living as a progress towards dying. The realization, as in making real, that the storytelling is always tinged with mortality, and that mortality, growing up, and then going out like a candle are always at the heart of all fiction. But there is more than that going on in this book, which we begin to sense as Alice goes through even more changes, up and down and up and down. These transformations make up most of the plot, and in the original version, Alice's Adventures Underground, they actually are all of the plot. Virtually every story in that early draft is a story about size, non-size-based narratives, as I now think of them. The lengthy trial at the end of the book and the tea party were all added later. The early stories really are about size. Now, to help you follow these changes and get some sense of just how disorienting they are, I've crafted this clever handout, which you have and I do not. But I just have a copy of it so I can tell you what you're looking at. Thank you. I've given you, just for curiosity's sake, both Tennille's drawings and Carol's own. And in the first one, you can see that she's in the house. She's reaching outside the house with the rabbit. I've given you the jurors. See, they look kind of like goldfish. And you've got the puppy scene. So I'm going to read through the description, and you can look at the pictures. Still tiny, she has gone into the rabbit's house in search of his gloves. Once there, she drinks from another bottle and grows so large that she finds her head pressing against the ceiling, that's the top of the page, and has to stop to save her neck from being frozen. Soon the other animals are throwing in tiny stones, which turn to cakes, as everything does in Wonderland. She eats them and shrinks again. Once out in the world, and this is the next page, she is terrorized by a puppy and must seize a little stick to tempt it off. All that, remember, when she is the uncomfortable 3 inches high. The book is obsessed, much like the realist novel and curiosity collections of the 19th century, with radical differences in size. They all have pictures of midgets standing next to giants. I don't know why. Every curiosity collection ever put together has to have that. Alice is that book. Alice has gone from being about 1,000 times as large as a rabbit, and considerably larger than the house that barely contains her, to being smaller than a puppy. Only when she finds a caterpillar and a mushroom about the same height as herself can she begin to manipulate her own size again. shooing off different sides of the mushroom, treating herself as an experiment in size, taller than trees, then shrinking suddenly with her head squishing her feet towards the ground, until with remarkable pleasure she succeeds in bringing herself to her usual height. That's not the end. Alice chooses not to say her usual size. She chooses to become the size of everyone around her. She brings herself back to 9 inches so that everyone else will talk to her. But I can't help but wonder, how does she know 9 inches? What in this world is the usual size? How does she know that it is she and not the tables, chairs, keys, locks, and even puppies that are moving, growing, changing? I offer this not just as a comic meditation, but as a response to repeated stagings of the Alice story, adaptations that question exactly what size of fiction is. As Carroll himself did, we can judge the self-consciousness with which Carroll asked this question by looking more carefully at his illustrations. And this is the final page of your handout. Thank you, Jim, for letting me read the book. While Tennille's drawings are painful and comical and a little awkward, Carroll's are downright horrifying. The scene where Alice is shut into a room that's on the right, you have to turn the page to get the full effect, suggests a painful distortion of the human body. This is like something out of a movie, scary. How could you get your arm at that angle, and how long could you manage to keep it there? But then look at the picture on the facing page, where Alice, with no visible bodily distortion, seems to reflect like Rossetti's Beata Beatrix on the bottle she's about to taste from. Look at the way the very world of print seems to close in on her, how bound in, boxed in she is by her own story. Like the writerly Alice, who thinks there should be a fairy tale about her, and that she will write it when she grows up, only to realize that there's no more room to grow here, being in the story seems to preclude having enough room to reflect upon it in any meaningful way. Now, I'm spending so long on this question of size for several reasons. First, it's just cool. It's intriguing in and of itself. Once a novel begins with a fixed size and makes things larger and smaller, it's so tempting to think we know how big they are, if they're bigger or smaller. But I'm drawn to the central instability of such evaluations and the question of how Alice can ever measure herself. At one point, she actually holds her hand on the top of her head to feel which way it was growing. And she was quite surprised to find that she remained the same size. Well, how can you measure yourself with yourself? Will that ever tell you anything? On the other hand, in this Wonderland world, what else can Alice use but herself as a measure? And that is, we remind ourselves, the measure of all things. This leads me to another of my obsessions with size, its relationship to the reality effect. In Alice, and in other forms of 19th century representation, and you could all think about all those tiny heroines in Bronte novels and anywhere else you look. What makes Alice so terrifying, and I'm back to my thesis here, is that it is not like a dream at all. It is perfectly like our world, and therefore immediately recognizable. The writer Catherine Ann Porter expressed this beautifully in a radio broadcast she did with Mark Van Doren and Bertrand Russell, and this is an amazing thing to read. If you haven't, you should go find it. She says that as a child, she feared Alice. She feared Alice. She didn't love it, unlike other books she read, because, and I'm quoting, "I believed in it entirely. Entirely. The difference between it and other fairy stories is that it all takes place in the setting of everyday life. The little glass table with the key on it, and the furniture, and the garden, and the flowers, these were all things we knew, you see. Familiar things dreadfully out of place, and they frightened me." Readers of Dickens will recognize this as the uncanny, what Dickens described as the romantic side of familiar things, and will see it as integral, not aberrant, but integral to the novel tradition, a world of familiar things dreadfully out of place, and equally of dreadful things making themselves quite to home in your parlor or your tea party. Think of the Moonstones. Alice doesn't learn a new game, for she knows the rules of croquet. What's terrifying is that she must accomplish the usual things in totally unusual ways. She must accomplish her goals while holding a flamingo still in her arms and chasing down her croquet ball, which is now a hedgehog and capable of wandering away. Nothing real is fixed, nothing fixed is real. No reader of Bleak House or Middlemarch will have trouble recognizing that universe. It's the universe of the realist novel. Our efforts to make sense of this quasi-realistic world are similarly vexed. Donald Racken has pointed out insightfully the gap between the child Alice and the adult narrator, arguing that the reader reads primarily with the narrator. As when Alice says she wouldn't cry if she fell off the top of the house, the narrator snarkily says, which is very likely true. Meaning, of course, she'd be dead, though I read the book a lot of times before I got that joke. Or when she tells herself, when she's a giant size, you ought to be ashamed of yourself, a great girl like you, to go on crying in this way, and the narrator says, she might well say this. Racken's example comes from the trial scene at the end of the novel when she says, I suppose there are jurors. She said the last word two or three times over to herself, being rather proud of it, where she thought, and rightly too, that very few little girls of her age knew the meaning of it at all. Here's what Rackham says about that. This self-assured joke by the narrator, the Aunt Rightly Too, that gently, even lovingly, perhaps ridicules Alice, who thinks that because she knows the name, she knows the meaning of it all, but instead knows nothing of the meaning. That joke invites the adult reader to laugh at, and at the same time, love Alice. That's a sweet reading, almost dear. I think it's ridiculous. It doesn't seem true to me or to the book, either. Rackham's analysis assumes not only our constant superiority to Alice, it ignores our dependence on her for any depiction of this strange world, but he assumes a fairly stable narrator. He assumes actually a stable Alice, a Alice who is always the same and to whom we have only one relationship. The narrator, in his reading of the book, always knows better, and Alice is always guessing a little, just what we'd expect from a heroine who consistently confuses growing up and growing up. But I don't agree that we are necessarily on the narrator's side in this, or that Alice is quite so ridiculous. And I want to draw our attention back to the curious child, who can not only pretend to be two people, but know that she is doing it, and who, it seems to me, has a better idea of what a jury does than anyone else in that courtroom. The running jokes about size and its secret sharer age are, I think, less jokes about growing up than jokes about perspective. And I think that this is the heart of Alice in Wonderland. The distortion of scale, rather than dream logic or whimsy or nostalgia, is how we know we are in Wonderland. To make this point, I want to turn now to two adaptations of Alice's adventure. The first from very early in the tradition, a 1903 film, and the other a 1980s rock video. In both, the signature mark of Alice-ness is games with size, or rather, as I'm arguing, games with perceptions of size. And I'm going to start with Cecil Hepworth's 1903 silent film version.
And if you can't see it too well, don't worry, you can come up later and I can talk you through it. But it's pretty amazing.
Thank you.
unbelievably good. This is 1903, and we've all seen the classic French special effects from the turn of the century. These are better. This is just completely amazing that he could do this in 1903. This was a 12-minute film that Cecil Hepworth made in his studio on the banks of the Thames. It ran about 12 minutes. It was like the longest film of its day. You could buy it in parks, which is my favorite thing about it, and so we can see it. And 8 minutes of it have survived. I mean, this is just completely amazing, because as you can see in the deterioration of the film, the minute the film was made, it started to decay. The very chemicals you use to fix the image would in turn eat the image. It's very ironic. As the critic points out, he doesn't have to tell you much of the story. This is one of the first narrative films made in the UK. And there isn't an American Alice until 1905, though. It's interesting that Edison made one pretty soon after, and this was also shown in America. But the first narrative films were either stories from the Bible or stories that everybody already knew. And Alice, obviously, was one of them. So there were something like, I think, 12 different scenes from the book, of which we have 8. It's completely amazing. But as I say, it's what I'm really interested in here is the special effects. The fact that when he went to say, what would a film of Alice look like, it was the games with size that he seized on, and that it pushed the medium further, that film had to do all these cool new things to get at this thing that we take for granted, wrongly, I would argue, in reading the novel. And this is accomplished, of course, not by changing the size of the actor. When I was little, I thought the people who sang on the radio were just very, very small. Where did they find a very tall and a very small Alice? No, 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 child. You do it by changing camera angles. You do it by changing the size of the props. But you have to move the props very subtly. Sometimes you do it, as in the puppy scene, by superimposing one film over the other. And this is a technique that came to film from Magic Lantern shows, and Hepworth got his start in doing Magic Lantern slideshows. There's this famous effect called Pepper's Ghost, which those of you who worked in 19th century early cinema will remember. So basically, this is a lot of it is Pepper's Ghost, but the size stuff is new. Notice, and this is my central point here again, how we can only judge the reality of the world, the size of things, by their size relative to the heroine. Although, technically speaking, she's the one getting smaller and bigger. In terms of the story, she's the thing being transformed. For us, she's the stable point. She's the fixed point by which we read the world. Again, to return to the doubleness of the heroine's curiosity, she's both the thing we are trying to read, how big is the world, and the consciousness through which we can read it. Alice's experiment in bigness gives us the world around her. This is not always a cheery offering, and I risk overestimating the heroine's resilience in the face of the often eerie, always unsettling transformations that she undergoes. Think of those poignant speeches she gives. What is happening to me? Am I myself? What am I becoming? What haunts these readings of Alice as a female curiosity elsewhere in tradition is the dark side of Rackham's gentle condescension towards Alice, the feeling that we, the readers, the grown-ups, know something the heroine doesn't know. And what we know is that she's going to die. What we also know, of course, is that she's going to fall into a world of adult sexuality. And that's where I'm going to turn to my second example, if I can have the video.
Thank you.
talk. We can have a little TP break. Okay, now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, sorry? Oh, Tom Petty, sorry. That was Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers from 1985. And I just a brief aside, I think for a lot of people who were not really sort of into the MTV thing, this video was when a lot of people started taking videos really seriously. I mean, this if you read in the literature, which why would you? This video just gets a lot of credit, and rightly. But you are thinking, and you are free to say so, Professor Schor, you have gone too far. You cannot make any of your claims about this video. This is not realism. That's barely Alice. There's no garden. They look like Disney characters. Who's stalking whom? But if you watch the whole video, there's an amazing scene where the heroine and the stalker are both walking downstairs over a chessboard. If you watch, as we did in the scene that I just showed, the teacups grow and shrink in her hands. If you watch, the heroine and the voyeur stalker artist hero switch places as his hat also shrinks and grows, as she shows up in her glasses and her bemused stare becomes his knowing smirk, size, knowledge, optics, terror, sex. Is this not the world of Alice we have been exploring here today? But finally, I'm not finally concerned with Tom Petty, or Cecil Hepworth, or even Lewis Carroll. I'm not actually all that fond of the Alice books myself. And as you can see, despite my deep fondness for some of the logic games of Wonderland, I can barely bring myself to mention The Looking Glass. I don't really think that this is a book about childhood. Now that might be that I hate childhood, and long hot summer days, and whimsy of just about every sort. My Alice is a different Alice, a curious young heroine on the verge of growing up and running, not falling or tripping, but running into a rabbit hole burning with curiosity. She makes her way all the way through these adventures and finds herself at last in a courtroom where, as Jonathan Miller has remarked, she finally attains her legal majority and for the first time grows on her own, without any magic aids, without, it seems, any real volition at all, but also, for the first time, without any terrible consequences. Nobody, for once, gets squished. Let us return to the books I began with, Jane Eyre, Daniel Deronda, Portrait of a Lady. From the moment Samuel Richardson asked, what is a Clarissa? The question of what a heroine, what an Alice is, has been at the heart of the realist novel. And often, as with our friend the pigeon, the answer has been, I know, she's a serpent. But this is a book that lets its heroine enter the garden. It doesn't drive her away. She doesn't come to grief in it. I want to celebrate that aspect of Alice, and I want to celebrate the novel's sense of curiosity, a curiosity that goes unpunished as well. Remember that other reason heroines look like serpents? As Robert Browning put it in A Woman's Last Word, what so false as truth is, false to thee. Where the serpent's tooth is, shun the tree. Where the apple reddens, never pry, lest we lose our Edens, Eve and I. Again, we have an Alice who doesn't get thrown out of the garden. To conclude then, in the 1860s, as Lewis Carroll was first telling and then writing his stories of Alice underground, one other man was sitting in Oxford thinking about curiosity. That man was the critic and poet Matthew Arnold. And here is what he had to say about curiosity. I have before now pointed out that we English do not, like the foreigners, use this word in a good sense as well as a bad one. With us, the word is always used in a somewhat disapproving sense. A liberal and intelligent eagerness about the things of the mind may be meant by a foreigner when he speaks of curiosity, but with us, the word always conveys a certain notion of frivolous and unedifying activity. But there is a curiosity about intellectual matters which is futile and merely a disease, but so there is certainly a curiosity, a desire after things of the mind simply for their own sake and for the pleasure of seeing them as they are, which in an intelligent being is natural and laudable. Like the novel in general and like the novel that bears her name, Alice can be dismissed as frivolous, unedifying, mere activity. Larger, smaller, grown up, little girl, dreamer, ignoramus. But I see both the realist novel and this novel in particular as involved in that most essential project of the liberal and intelligent mind in the 19th century, one that continues to inform our own realist project, that of seeing things as they are, of trying to measure the world, of trying to know our place in it, What better way to carry out this project than through an intelligent young woman, trying out new words and new worlds, testing her antipathies, and straining her vision against the shifting of the light, the tilting of the ceiling, the limits of the page. This is what intrigues me here today and always, the blend of knowingness, magic, and sheer unknowability of the curious heroine poised on a world of wonder. Only a trick of photography can render her clear to us. It is those tricks of vision, the rendering of a real world suddenly uncanny, that is the heart of the curious world. Thank you.
Anyways,
absolutely do. I really do. And that's why in the longer version I will talk more about the trial and the legal status of women at the time. By the 1860s, there's a large and quite sophisticated public discourse about feminism, which Lewis Carroll would absolutely have known. And one of the interesting things about Lewis Carroll, and Catherine Robson can talk more about this than I, or most people, is that there's a strange parallel to his relationship with girls, to grown-up women as well. I mean, he had a surprising number of kind of independent, feisty, sexually active female friends. And it's kind of curious. I mean, scholars were trying to arrest him from the, or rescue him from the charge of pederasty. Trying to rescue him from pederasty, often are now making arguments about how oversexed he was, how the girls were a cover story for all these grown-up women. So it's a little hard to know, because on the face of it, he's a don, he's single his whole life, he's a mathematician, and this is not a world in which adult sexual relationships figure, period. And as I was beginning to say, and I had to cut that part of the paper short for time, there's a way throughout this tradition of the 19th century novel, and that's what really interests me, that the books are really saying, who do you think you are, over and over, to these curious girls? And that's the paragraph I had to cut, was basically, oh, who do you think you are now? You can't even stand up straight in the room. You're, you know, somewhere between the bed and the ceiling, and that's where you belong. And there's something about the viciousness of the constraints on Alice that, to my mind, is not sexist or patriarchal, but highlights the constraints on any woman trying to move freely in this world. And that's why the novels that I began with, Daniel Deronda, Middlemarch, Jane Eyre, Portrait of a Lady, are novels that self-consciously, Emma, ask the question, what is a woman of independent means and intelligence and beauty to do in the world? What can she do with herself? And it's a bit of a stretch to say that Lewis Carroll is joining in the public debate over women's rights in the 1860s, but I've read a lot of Carroll criticism, and people take enormous stretches all the time, so I feel absolutely, absolutely free to do it. And it seems to me it's a slightly more generous way, apologies to my colleague Jim Kincaid, who is brilliantly scornful of Alice's attempts to become a queen, but it's another way of reading Looking Glass and the effort to become a queen, to jump over squares and come into full authority. And if I've talked about Looking Glass in connection with this question, I would have talked about, I read one of those many, you know, Alice and Chess articles on the theory that you really only had to read one. So I read one. But it made a really good point, which was that Alice is in the position of a pawn that doesn't know what the rest of the game is doing. And that throughout the book, you're seeing the moves only from her point of view. And that's, again, where I think the Alice books intersect with this tradition. The heroines think they're so smart. They think they're all that. They've got it figured out. And this is the punchline of my book, and it was the punchline of the paragraph I had to cut, that not only do they not know what they don't know, but the point of these novels over and over again is they don't know that everybody else knows it, and everyone knows that they don't. So over and over again, yeah, it's a terrible tradition. The heroine reaches the end of the novel having been struggling to get to a better world all the way through it, only to realize that, oh my God, I wanted a better world and I married Gilbert Osmond. You know, that can't be what I had in mind. And to learn that everyone else knew what a mistake you were making all along. But my argument of how this intersects with 19th century political discourse, and particularly Matthew Arnold and John Stuart Mill, whom I invoked at the end of the essay, is that what the novel wants for women is what Mill wants for women, the freedom to make mistakes, the freedom to choose. And I think that's an incredibly important tradition in the 19th century to rescue. And I have to say, you come up at lunch, please, and tell me all the things I got wrong. But working on this paper, I kind of convinced myself that Alice really belongs in that tradition, and it has something to say even to that discussion of female independence and autonomy, the freedom to make mistakes. So that, again, goes back to playfulness and curiosity and many of the things that Professor Kincaid was saying about Alice when we began, that I think the criticism of the last few years has uncovered so brilliantly. Other questions? Yes?
The longer version of your paper, you refer to, is that published, to be published, is something you're working on?
It's something I'm working on. Yeah, it exists in my head, and in my head it's very smart. It won't be when it's done, but in my head right now, man, it's the best paper, yeah.
It's a chapter in that book.
It's going to be the introduction. I'm actually, I'm going to begin the introduction with the curiosity shop, and I'm going to be able to talk about the curiosity shop in the Looking Glass, and the way objects turn into other objects constantly, then focus on the heroine. And it's going to end with science fiction. It's going to end with the thing that I wanted to do today and couldn't, which was to talk about Joss Whedon's new science fiction film, Serenity, which has an amazing girl heroine, River Tam, and the question about her is she a girl or is she a weapon? And there's this amazing scene where she walks downstairs into a bar, Pomo Bar on an outside planet. It's a Western sci-fi, brilliant, brilliant, weird movie. And she's triggered by a video message, and she suddenly goes into full-on assassin mode and starts kickboxing everybody into tarnation. She actually can kick her leg around a bar. The actress trained as a ballet dancer, and when the stuntman thought out she could do that, he put in this scene. But what the film does is it follows her in. Her face goes completely blue and white. She looks at the screen, and she says one word, Miranda, which is like this total brave new world Tempest moment. And then immediately goes into killer mode and finally is dropped by a magic word and falls to the ground. And the rest of the film is finding out what Miranda is and what the secret of this heroine is. And it's Alice. I mean, it's the Tempest, of course. But it's really Alice. And so I just think you can follow this line from the 18th century out into the future and just, I don't know, I believe it. Even if I don't believe it, it's really fun. Question in the back.
Knowing only this talk and listening to your emphasis on growth and maturation and seeing the two video clips from 03 and 85, I'm struck that what appears to be going on is some emphasis on the limits of the discourse of childhood or the limits of the discourse or the representation of childhood and a leap into adolescence for which there is yet no specific language. Could you comment on that?
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. Do you all hear that the leap into adolescence? And the question, as little as we have a language for childhood, do we have even less of a language for adolescence? The one thing I will not be doing to write this book is reading tween novels. there's this new genre of tween novels. I think the traveling pants are among them. It's a funny thing. I wanted to write about how old Alice is, but then the paper would have been a year long. Because I'm trying to read size as a cognate for age. And I wanted to show there's an amazing moment in Dream Child, my favorite Alice movie, where the very young and the very old Alice Little are both in a scene with the characters and Charles Dodgson. And I wanted to talk about that complicated sense we have of age and youth coexisting in all the figures in the book. Another really interesting film adaptation is the one that Jonathan Miller did for the BBC. And if you haven't seen it, you should see it. It's weird, probably not very likable, but really interesting. And if you buy the DVD, it has the 1903 Alice on it. I know. Isn't that just amazing? You can just buy this stuff. So weird. But he talks about why he chose an 11-year-old actress. That he just couldn't get the range of Alice-ness out of a 7-year-old. And his Alice is very pre-Raphaelite, heavy-haired. Most of her speeches are given in voiceover to make her seem even more removed and distant. And she resembles nothing so much as the teen adolescent heroines of Peter Weir's Picnic at Hanging Rock. So very much that idea that in the teenage girl is a sexual mystery we'll never solve. So I think that's one element of it. But the question of how old even Lewis Carroll's Alice is, I mean, in the book she's 7, the real Alice was 10, going on 11. To me, and I know nothing about children, nothing, except to beat them when they sneezes. The only thing things I know about children actually come from knowing 11-year-olds. I mean, 11 is actually my favorite age in a young person. I have no interest in children until they're 11, and I lose interest very rapidly thereafter. But if you know any 11-year-olds, they're amazing, right? I mean, they're exactly at that moment when they're figuring out the complicated stuff. They're beginning to make mortality jokes. So it's always seemed to me that this Alice is older than 7, and all of you who have charming and precocious 7-year-olds are going to rise up like a pack of cards and tell me that I'm wrong, that, your little Jimmy is just like Alice, only nicer. But I think there's a reason it's hard to know how old Alice is. The other reason, of course, is Jim Kincaid's reason, which is also a good one, which is that children are much more like adults than we want to think, that children you know, they have rules and they have maxims and they know what's good and bad, and they're much more rigid in their thinking than adults who want to be playful and scamper around and not turn things in on time. And children are very fretful and they want to know what the penalties are and what will happen next. And so I think there's something quite accurately childlike about not knowing how old Alice is. And if you think about one's tedious, I mean, really interesting friends who love to tell you stories about their children, I mean, most of those truly, truly delightful stories about other people's children, most of them are weird moments when kids come up with grown-up things, right? Most of kids say the darndest things, a genre I abhor, is, and then he said this thing that sounded like a barrister, right? So I think the central joke, let's put a wig on the child, let's do a Tom Thumb wedding. But I do want to push that further. I want to push it towards the argument about nostalgia and death and storytelling. And I take very seriously the jokes about going out like a candle. I mean, those moments when Alice wonders what the flame thinks when it goes out. I mean, you could say a child in a book is just a receptacle for our ideas. You can say, as Jonathan Miller very much does in his film version, which again, I would recommend, although if you hate it, don't tell me. You could say, this is the Wordsworthian child, trailing clouds of glory and the little bastion of romantic ideas. But I'd also like to see some more interesting story told about female identity on the verge of adolescence. That's the way I read little Nell, who is 14, not 11. And that's the way I read Alice. I really can't make much sense of this book if it's really about a seven-year-old. Although again, I must say, what does it mean for a fictional character to really be any age?